Hello, and welcome to Prelude 2015, the final day. My name is Tom Seller. I'm the co-curator of this year's edition with Antje Ugel, who's over there. And we would like to welcome you and thank you for coming this afternoon. This is a showcase of four short pieces or four excerpts from works in progress. The first piece many of you just experienced, that was Phillip Howze's Self-Portrait number 7. And we will now continue in the order that it is printed in the program with Lisa Jesse Peterson's Peculiar Patriot, Larissa Velez-Jackson's Star Crab Method, and Ben Gassman's piece Sam's Tea Shack. Following the fourth of the four performances, we will have a post-performance discussion, which will be moderated by Noel Allain from the Bushwick Starr, who is here. And we also want to let you know that you are all very much invited to our closing night performances and closing night party, which will be at the Pioneer Works in Red Hook, Brooklyn. There are buses leaving from this location at 7:30 and 7:45. They will take you, they'll whisk you magically to Red Hook into the most incredible space. The space alone is worth the trip. But at 8 o'clock, there will be a series of performances hosted by Aaron Markey in the Pioneer Works. And then that will be followed by our closing night party, which will be DJed by the illustrious Blacks. It's gonna be an absolutely fantastic party. So I encourage everyone to come. It is free, open. It's going to go late into the night. So come after whatever else you're doing, bring your friends, bring everyone. It's a huge, huge factory warehouse space. We have room for everybody. So please do come. Thanks.
sorry, it took so long up here to see you. You know that's not like me. And Nasir said he was coming to see you and he invited me both times. I figured, you know, let me fall back so you can spend some time with your husband. You know, you my homie for strong me, wonder twin power for life. You know how we rock, girl. I miss you so much. I got so much to tell you. But how are you doing? You all right? Yeah, well, you look good, too. Well, how did that situation turn out with you and that chick that you was working with in the hair salon? Yeah, y'all squashed that beef? Okay, that's good, because you know I didn't want to have to come up here and put the Vaseline on my face. You know, like, what? You know, do a little prison break. What'd she say about trying to take your dates? Okay, as long as you good. Y'all work that out? Girl. About 2 weeks ago, up on 125th Street up in Harlem, and I run into Miss Jefferson. You remember Miss Jefferson? She was my guidance counselor when we were locked up back in juvenile detention. Girl, that was my baby. Miss Jefferson was like my jail mother when I was locked up. She was the one that got me quilted in the first place. Because, girl, you know I wasn't hardly thinking about no quilting class up in juvenile detention. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but she used to bring her like homemade cookies and cornbread for the girls in the class. So since I was her favorite, I was like, Miss Jefferson, I live. She was like, Betsy, you want some of these treats? You have to come to class and sew. And I was like, well, give me a needle and some bread, because girl, you gonna want some of that cornbread. And girl, I got up in that class and I got hooked on quilting. Yes. So Miss J asked me, so when I saw her, like she asked me, was I still a quilter? Which I honestly haven't done since that in juvie. She didn't like hearing that. She told me I need to get some fabric pronto. And I got to thinking about quilting again. And I have a surprise for you. I started a quilt, and guess who's going to be the first patch? Yes. So let me show you your square. Oh, thank you, baby. I gave you a full moon because you're full of potential. And I'm putting 3 shooting stars on it, one for each of your kids. That's Mookie, that's Jewbug, and that's Nene. Yeah, and I gave you a yellow ribbon. Because you got to tie a yellow ribbon around that old, old tree. That's right, because you're coming home soon. Baby. I was so happy to see Miss Jefferson. She screamed, "Get Betsy Ross!" There was a little nickname for me, Betsy Ross. Because I had made a quilt in memory of my father. And I sewed a bunch of, you know, Black Panther designs on the different squares. It was mad fly, yo. So she said my quilt was like a Black liberation flag. And I was the best quilter in the class. Yes. Her class was the shit. We'd be up in there eating, sewing, having a good old time, talking about everything under the sun. And you know, Miss Jefferson, she was real like Afrocentric. She was always teaching us about Black history and stuff like that. Yeah, she used to sound just like my dad sometimes too. And when I told her that my dad was a Black Panther and all that happened to him, girl, she took me under her wing like I was her project. I can appreciate it now, but at the time, that shit felt like a punishment. Cause she went in on trying to school me, giving me extra reading assignments. I mean, I went along with it cause she used to let me call my grandmother from her office all the time, and she would sneak me new underwear and those regular sanitary napkins so I didn't have to use them fucked up jail pads. I love me some Miss J and her quilting class. She told us how to quilt the Underground Railroad to help us escape. Y'all, they were so secret messages and codes into the patterns and the quilts. So, yeah, so when the snake is running bush trying to escape, if they got to a house or saw one of those quilts hanging outside, they knew that house was safe to go to for food as a shelter. Yes, Miss Jefferson was deep. Mm-hmm. And you know, niggas be like, ooh, 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 hey, running from the cops. Well, she said that those are ancient tribal pools from back in Africa, and we're still and don't even realize the connection.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I told you I put a yellow ribbon on your patch because you are coming home, so we gotta tie a yellow ribbon around that old oak tree. No crying. He said we wasn't gonna cry this visit. You're trying to get me to cry already now. Come on, I'm just so much too goofy. Okay, 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 we're not gonna go there, we're not gonna go there. Your asthma hasn't been acting up lately, has it? Okay, okay, well, I'm dating this guy named Pablo. Mm-hmm. He is fine. Remember when we watched that John Singleton movie, Baby Boy, together? Okay, now you remember that scene where Big Brains was scrambling eggs, naked in the kitchen, drinking that Kool-Aid? I was like, well, bam! And Pretty, he got all of them too. He ain't no snaggy too. And his hair, silky and nappy. He got them smooth buttermilk cornrows. He's a black Indian. Yes, baby. Mmm! Girl, he look just like Tyrone, that beard by the Red Rooster. Yes! What? Since he bull buck blacker. Crazy horse mixed with Africa. Chocolate tall Mississippi buffalo soldier. And gentle. Talking about deer. Now eat right from his hand. We show them deer here. I mean him. He said you ain't never lived till you had a fawn. A fawn. AWN. Girl, it's a baby deer. Like nibble apple out the palm of your hands or be this quiet of the forest. Watch a cow get birth. He's an animal lover. He's a talking squirrel type of brother. Girl, you know me too well. Got his ass locked up selling drugs. I said, oh, don't let the he who talk with squirrels fool you. Yeah, he showed me some pictures. Papa Don used to push a fully equipped black ex. Wrist, bling, bling, diamonds, leather, jewels, out, talking about he was a gun, took with a crew of soldiers on the payroll. I was like, well, isn't that a dichotomy? From bullets, from BMB. Guess I told Pablo, I said, look, if you want to be with me and you want this relationship to work, I need to be convinced that you are ready to commit to non-destructive, healthy choices in your life and that you have left all of them illegal hustling episodes in the past. See, because you are not the first jailbird, ex-con, class A, B, C, I done dealt with, and I will know if you up these up, so don't play me. Now, you might not be addicted to drugs, but you damn sure might still be addicted to the game. I will know the difference because candy sprinkles on top some shit. You want to have the stink. I prefer paper honesty over sugar-coated deceit anyway. And since you can't build truth on top of lie, and I'm about building the truth, come real with your shit, baby. Come real with your shit. I am not here to judge you because that is one thing that Betsy LaPorn divorce does not judge, because the Bible says, let he who is without sin cast the first stone. But I am vengeful. That's the man that cost me 10 years to get you back. back if you cross me. And trust me, it won't take me 10 years to get you back if you cross me. No, I'm not trying to come off on you gangster or nothing like that. I'm just trying to let you know what you're dealing with up front so you can decide whether or not you want to have a cup of tea with me. Have you accepted the challenge and strengthened the community? By using your entrepreneurial genius and your political street savvy to rebuild the ghetto nation and teach the youth options beyond the drug culture? He was like, yeah. I broke my rule. After Curtis, who was my one exception to the rule, I promised myself I was not going to get romantically involved. No more guys coming fresh out the pen. Now, no, I know what I told you. I told you no more PPP, no more post-penitentiary pussy. That's what I told you. I don't know, girl. Shut up. Something about him. He's real confident and political. He took me to be his parole officer. And plus for a Bambi, you know I checked his rap sheet. I'm lying, girl, right on the internet. www.jailbird.com. Up there. Possession of narcotic with intent to distribute heroin and cocaine, class A felon. Didn't lie. That they locked him up for committing a crime against poverty. I said crime against poverty. Well, let me think about that one. No, I mean, no, he knows he was wrong selling drugs.
But on the real though, Ma, if the government was really serious about ending the war on drugs, they wouldn't keep coming after the petty street foot soldiers or the low ranking commandos, you know what I mean? Cause soon as you lock one up, there's gonna be another one to hit the block and take his spot. They just gonna keep coming back like roaches. Yeah, you gotta cut off the head of operations. Big dog, hit the suppliers and shit. You think about it, Ma. With all this top of the line 007 matrix type I spy shit the government got, they could probably see me and you sitting right here having a conversation right now, Mommy. I was reading something the other day in the New York Times, because you know I read the New York Times. And on Tuesday, they had the science section, and they working on a camera that looks like a bumblebee, Mom. A fucking bumblebee. So you think it's a fly or bug buzzing around, your ass is under surveillance. Not shit like that. So you mean to tell me they don't know who's supplying what to who, who's shipping what in? Think about it, Ma. The only reason why drugs are still rocking and flowing is because Old Glory and the cut. Yeah, the financial benefits from the drug economy is too great to shut this shit down. This is a capitalist country, Ma. Drug money, blood money is still money as long as it accumulates and circulates by any means necessary. This is Wild Wild West, so I figured, wrong, do the wrongs. Word up.
Girl, ain't he something? I mean, what he's saying is right, even though selling drugs is wrong, you know what I'm saying? But girl, the way I look at it, come on, we done all sinned and kissed the devil at least once. Ain't nobody exempt from that. Girl, it's about redemption, not perfection. Because even the cops and the lawmakers be the lawbreakers sometimes. Don't please, look at Congress. Half of them. It's fucking intern hoes, having affairs, married, mouthing off about morality, and the other half of them is probably getting high off of the drugs that they mandatory sentence and niggas for selling. Girl. Honey, 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 it is crazy. Poppy. Poppy be dropping mad politics. Yeah. We be having deep conversations. He be getting so heated. I don't know, I just like his take on
things. Cause it's definitely a war, all right.
Child, what?
Honey, prisons are jumping off the damn hook like Jiffy, providing the main source of the economy for these upstate trailer park windmill rural daily life communities.
Yeah.
All the while politicians are filling their constituency bellies with nigger snacks.
What you mean, nigger snacks. Come on, girl. We are a nutritional treat.
As soon as a prison is built, it provides steady year-round employment, not to mention the rest stops that are making more money because you've got more people coming upstate to visit their loved ones. Plus, the people living in these rural, wonderbread white communities weren't earning any real substantial income until, drumroll, the prison got built. Yes, Billy Bob, Mary Joe, and Jimmy Joe, and Jimmy Ray are now government employees, earning a very nice coin, complete with pensions, benefits, and all that nice fluffy shit. Where there was once just a country dirt road is now a newly constructed strip mall to meet the demand of the entire community, which has miraculously increased their earning power thanks to the prison. The whole community gets a facelift. And it is fascinating to note that the government money for districts is based on the number of people living in a district. Well, these underpopulated rural white towns, they get to count the number of inmates in their census. So, on paper, it looks like they have more residents than they actually do. Therefore, they get more money from the state to build their healthcare clinics, community centers, basketball courts, you know, stuff like that. Our nigger snack numbers, these rural white doesn't benefit our neighborhoods, where the niggas come from. Mm-hmm. That's why they come looking for us, stopping and frisking us. We're straight cash money trucks. And some of these towns have more inmates than residents. More inmates than residents. Yes, crime does pay for certain people and certain communities. Girl, God bless the internet. You can just call me Google Mommy. Because you're going to have to believe this. Girl, I'm telling you, listen. This prison shit really is slavery. No, it ain't, no, it's not a metaphor. Girl, they got this shit hooked up. It's a racket. Yes, I'm telling you. Some of these prisons are privately owned. Yes, private companies, corporations own some of these prisons, meaning I can go down to Wall Street today and I can invest in a private prison and I can make some money off of your black ass sitting right here, right now. And think I haven't thought about it? Girl, the privatization of prisons is financially driven. Yes, they're getting huge profits up in this piece. I'm telling you, rest assured, all y'all niggas up here ain't up in here for punishment. Most of y'all up in here for profit. Yes! Matter of fact, well, they got a private company over in England that owns two private prisons here in America. I said, well, goddamn, everybody's in on the American prison grading train. Yeah, got y'all up in here working for 15, 20 cent an hour like it's Taiwan. And in prison is the new China. Child, war on drugs is a trip. And you know how I be going in. Yeah, girl. Mm-hmm. You know how I be, right? So I showed Pablo my little pie chart I made. Hey, Pablo, you know pie chart, anything, huh? Yes. He was so impressed. He took out a piece of paper and a pen and he started taking some notes. I was like, I'm feeling you. When I told him that in New York State, not the city, but the entire state, the majority of drug dealers is white.
of all the drug offenders locked up in New York State prisons, something like 95% are black and Latino, girl. They doing the crime, but we doing time. I'm telling you, girl, I started kicking my little funky bobo to Pablo, honey. You could have fried an egg on his head and boiled some soup. I'm so mad. See there? Yep. See, that's their bullshit. That's what I'm talking about. All right, so now the way you breaking it down, statistics, so mathematically, you know what I'm saying? I'm just a born, made criminal's war strategy. These white motherfuckers been playing dirty, though. You ain't really saying nothing new, because you know the Constitution says that slavery is still illegal except for punishment of a crime. You picked the motherfucking loophole, mommy, except for punishment of a crime. So, if you commit a crime, then you can become a legal slave. Yeah, the okie doke. Part of my back in slavery time, right? You had to work for free. He ain't have no say in the matter. That was it. That was the law. White motherfuckers was caping off of all that free labor for 100 years. No payroll, just profit. Now that's a hustler's dream, baby. But when slavery ended, nigga could sit down and relax, try to get his mind right. He ain't have to do shit for the white man. So what the crack can do, ma? They made laws making it a crime to not have a job. Making shit like you could get arrested for laughing or looking them in the eye, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, hit me a crack and said you did real devil type shit. So now, all of a sudden, the black man is getting locked up feverishly, you heard? Motherfucking slave master, he ain't got no more slaves, but now he can get him some convicts and do slave work for free, legally. Same nigga, same job, same zero. That's a different title. Yeah, mommy, they know about that. Yeah. I be reading up on a lot of deep informative shit. I don't read the hood drama books, you know what I'm saying? Plus, my life is more fascinating anyway. I need to write a book, you heard? I seek knowledge. I'm a different type of dude like that. So now, look at this shit today, ma. Mad niggas is locked up. We convicted legal slaves. These ain't nothing but old war games, honey. I can give it to the white man, though. No. Mad strategic with his shit. War on drugs is really a war on me. So technically, that makes me a POWOD, a prisoner of war on drugs. So where's my flag? Where's my motherfucking flag? Word up. I'm telling you.
What?
Oh, damn, girl, it's time to go already. I just got here. I miss you too. I love you. Okay, call me.
Yeah, write me. You owe me 2 letters. I wrote you 3. You only wrote me 1, so you owe me 2. I'm doing math. 4. All right.
Starcraft method. Solo. I need a lot of these tools here. Because I'm in my very late 30s, slightly arthritic, and in order to do all of the major stuff that's going to happen, I need to give myself a little comfort. And also, as you notice, Starcraft method is about taking your time and allowing whatever little banal moments you want to have happen for yourself. Let them happen. Okay? I also like to call this anti-climax. Sort of a continuous anti-climax. But Starcraft method also has within it regular some of these tools create a choreography of their own, like a ready-made choreography. Objects. I got that on Amazon. And as many folks in the cities have these plantar fasciitis and all kinds of issues of the feet, this is a lovely tool that you can purchase and have in your arsenal of self-care. Body comfort. I choose to get this and incorporate on stage in my practice. Finished with that now. As the arms transition between external rotation and internal rotation, internal rotation, external rotation, internal rotation, I say, it's the star cut method. I can talk the moment while swiping as I direct eye contact with the you all. Welcome. Purposely bowing toward the role in that. So, although when I take time to be around lovely objects, I wonder if I'm in a solo anymore. Objects are here.
Thank you. would roll with certain impediments. Totally there. I said phenomenologically, I'm totally there. Even it has a function.
Ballet has not functioned. Realizing that I've been silent for a while, so I just command myself to start talking because I walk on relevé. It's not a ballet walk, it's just a pedestrian relevé walk. Ballet got me thinking about that, and so that's what's happening now. Enjoying? So, helicopter-like situation.
Where's the other microphone, Larissa?
It's in the trunk cellar. Here it is. It's not on.
Now it's on. I'm sitting on top of the trunk cellar. His belly moves when he laughs, and I can feel that on my derriere. And I can feel your chin rubbing just a little bit as I see your legs going near, 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 near. Would you like that microphone? Oh gosh. Thank you, Tom Seller. Here, you take this, Tom.
Legs together. Legs apart together. Legs apart together. Legs apart. Legs apart. Not together.
Thank you. Thank you. Sophomore girl, and she probably wasn't more than 18, but she was wearing her very limited choice clothing in such a way, you know, you could just tell she was cool. And I don't know, I'd done a lot of partying the night before, I'd done a lot of cocaine the night before, and I was in a strange mood, and I asked her if she would like to drive. She said, no, thank you. I asked her if she knew what day it was, and she said yes. I said, I don't mean like the 24th of Kislev or whatever. I mean the day on the Julian calendar. She said January 1st. And I asked her if that meant anything to her, and she said no. I said, well, I was like a detective. I was like, you're an American. No? You? said, yes. And I said, well, you know, the Julian calendar is the calendar we use here. So even if it doesn't have some kind of spiritual significance, it has to mean something. I mean, I don't even know what it means to me, but my day job. She just laughed and licked her ice cream cone. And she was very pretty, and I was feeling daring, and I wasn't thinking about her 27 brothers and uncles stoning us both to death. So I asked again about driving. I said, I know women in your community are not allowed to drive, and I don't know why. And she said, it's not that we're not allowed to drive, it's that we choose not to drive. And I said, so if you really wanted, you could just get a car and go up to Muncie or something? And she said, well, I need a license first. I said, could I get the rabbi to give you one? She said, no, I need one from the work. And I said, but really, your father would allow you to get one? And she said, I don't want to drive. I was like, look, outside, let's just get in my car, we'll drive around the block a few times, I'll show you how the pedals work. She giggled again, waved bye, and then she probably got married to someone from the community, better should've, if you will. And they had four kids last week. Does everyone have tea that wants tea? This is a very good tea. Anyone else need a cup of tea? Is there Jones in the audience? I know she really loves tea. Anyone? Oh. Please. Oh. Anything here? I just wanna say Baruch Adonai Eloheinu Melech Olam Hooray Pri E. The Lubavitchers are a very different people than the Satmar. The Satmar, you know, the Lubavitchers compared to the Satmar are joyous, happy. They just want you to shake those up in the edge. On a form that asks for race, I'm supposed to check white, but people, I'm an assortment. I'm a line. My people are these Semitic nomad people. See, that's why Judaism is matrilineal. When the Lord's is a Jew. I started out by researching the Bukharian Jew. And now it fucking turns out I am a Bukharian Jew. Or I might be. My grandmother, her deathbed looked Chinese. Like Uyghur, like Mongolian, not like a Han, like a tribal person from the Caucasus. Then I went for a trim a few months ago, and I told my father's barber that I think we might be Bukharian, and he got a little bit uncomfortable. Then I told him we're probably all Khazars anyway, and he got incredibly offended. But I might be. You know, there's a lot going on in the family tree. See, in the mid-90s, the Italian barbers just disappeared from my neighborhood. And all of a sudden, there were these Uzbeki barbers, and they were Jews. Then, a friend takes me to this restaurant in Regal Park called Cherokhnaya, like a Bukharian place, to eat a soup called lagman with one very long noodle. I'm vegetarian, but I ate some of the noodles. Allegedly, my great-grandmother says we come from Azerbaijan. I would have liked to have met her. I'd like to take her to a strip club in Baku, right on the shore of the sea, a bottle service, and do our drugs, and put some shekels in the girls' G-strings while we talk about the ancient relatives. Shanah Tova! Next year in Baku, may it be filled with honey. You know, the main narrative is that we have the Asian in us because of the Genghis Khan's horde came. I mean, probably other people here have that same story, right? A little bit among them. And then, Liza? See, like a lot of, I mean, you know, a lot of people have Genghis Khan in them. But, you know, for me, I've always been fascinated by the Caspian Sea, of course, you know, and the Caucasus. Right? Julia, didn't we read Caspian and they got excited to see that the Caspian Sea was there? I'm depressed. Because my uncle has a family chest. Inside is a letter written in Judeo-Persian with pictures of teeth. I think I'm a Khazar. My uncle's a psychiatrist. I saw my grandmother dead at the morgue and he made me touch her. She was on a slab. I'm the only one of the cousins that touched her. You know, now my uncle is talking to me because he feels like I don't make enough effort to communicate. Which is funny because I touched a dead person. I mean, what more effort to communicate? He wants. He wanted me to see what cold felt like. I just wanted to say goodbye. Sorry. I only share toilets with, and I only share toilets with people fucking. If I'm not sleeping with someone and they use a toilet, I put paper down. Even in my own home. Look, I don't want to put my ass where another person's ass is unless I'm fucking them. But the Dalai Lama. He's my spiritual guru. I feel very intimate with him spiritually, very attached to him. But unless I'm fucking him or he's fucking me, I mean, look, he's old. You know, what if he has sores on his ass? I don't want second-hand aid of this fistula, if you will, his hemorrhoids, whatever he has going on down there. But if we're sleeping together, I'm all mixed up. Maybe I would share a toilet with the Dalai Lama. I do like to mix the spiritual and the scatological. It's like one day. Show up in a t-shirt. The proprietress is like, here, my husband made these samsi. Have a samsa to go with your tea. It's fucking great. Get on your camel, 15 miles on down the road, you get to the next t-shirt. You're tired, the camel probably has some intestinal distress. You get your tea and you're like, hey, I got a samsa. And the guy's like, what the fuck are you talking about? It's a samsa. Smoke? Samsa? Samosa? I guess I could try to make one. See how Buddhism spread. It took 1,000 years for Buddhism to travel from India. I'd be patient. My ancient namesake, ancestor Shmuel traveled to China. He went because he sent him. Poor Darius. I fucking know. One of these Persian emperors puts an end to Isfahan the Tsar Gazette. Now Shmuley's just perusing his tablet of chicken salts one day. By the way, kosher chicken salts. He said to himself, I don't really have a thing right now. I mean, I have interests. I don't really have a vote. And then he sees jobs available. The emperor is looking for some good men. The emperor needs someone to bring our awesome rugs to the east and bring back some of that lovely floral green tea. Or bring some textiles there and bring some cumin back. I don't know. But he went. So Shmuley goes over the first big mountain. And the second big mountain, and the third big mountain, and the fourth big mountain. He sees the Buddhas in Afghanistan, and I get so choked up there because it would be awesome. You know, and he's into them, and he doesn't reject them. And eventually, He yurts up with a Mongolian yak herder's daughter. I mean, why not? He's up for adventure. Nothing's tying him down. Mongolian yak herder's daughter is extremely attractive. The herder's busy with his herd, and he has 11 daughters. He's not overly protective. And the mother? Let me tell you, the mother is a liking to Shmuel. I dare say encourages the whole thing, or at least tacitly by smiling knowingly, turning the other way, and by preparing for the young lovers what is commonly known in the arts, national. Noel's first taste of treif, if you will, for the matrimonial kilah, obviously included the freshwater mollusks of the hall. Not sentient, if I may. And had the yak herder's daughter, wouldn't have turned down the kilah either. Though I this one time in the Jewish Museum, after looking at this centuries-old exquisite wrist set, I met this Romanian Jewish man who was visiting and also looking at the wrist set. And I mentioned something to him about the Khazars, and he was furious that I would even bring up the Khazars. See, the Khazars are this nomadic people, a Turkic people, probably from that area north of the Caspian Sea. If I may, I think that, you know, the Turkic people eventually then came to rule Anatolia, if you will, which is now called Turkey, but I believe those people are more like Central Asian originally. Amira, would you say that that? Anyway, it's something like that these Turkic people in the 700s adopted Judaism, and nowadays, sometimes, like, for instance, like white supremacists will use it to say that, like, you know, the Ashkenazi Jews had no claim to Jerusalem. BTW, I've never been to Israel, nor have my parents been to Israel. You know, I'm a New York Jew, and that's a different thing. So if I'm a Khazar, I don't, like, that doesn't bother, you know what I mean? Like, since the 700s, good for me, you know, like, good enough for me, like, not related to Abraham, but related to, like, the log of the offices. Great. Final thing I'd like to say about all of that, because I think that there's relation to everything that we've been talking about. If you ask me, do I feel any connection to the Bukharian Jews? I feel just as connection to them as I do to the Satmar Hasids, those creepy weirdos in my neighborhood. Now, when I see Woody Allen, Mel Brooks film, I think these are my people. Okay, I eat one of Babo's sweet and sour vegetarian dumplings. I do feel kind of weird. But it's just like against all odds, right? All four lines, you know, all the way down the fucking tree, I'm a Jew. So now people might get upset when I say I'm 100% Jew. Like, what am I saying? That's crazy. I'm a pure-blooded Jew. I mean, it's like I've never even been to temple. I was bar mitzvahed in Yankee Stadium. And they don't mean like some Dalton kid whose parents like rented out Yankee Stadium for his bar mitzvah. I mean like my dad's coworker, Johnny Lombardozzi, got some tickets for the game. And then like later when I was a teenager, he took us to a shooting range in Staten Island. And then Johnny Lombardozzi like had like a foot in a few. But, I mean, like, who even knows if I'm a pure blood issue anyway? I'm sorry. Excuse me, is anyone in the audience a phrenologist? Sometimes, I just like to stop a Hasidic on 47th Street. I like to just stop him and start running my fingers through his beard. and emeralds and rubies and dandruff just falls to the ground and sings. I'd really like for the emeralds and rubies to fall to the ground and sing effortlessness that the dandruff falls. And I'd say, Shabbat shalom, hey, as I'm rhythmically stroking his beard. Perhaps I might even finger Teus. And he'd say, ah, just a hand job, or the equivalent in Yiddish. And I'd say, want to go bowling and then have a Pulp Fiction Shabbat? And he'd say, I'm Shomer fucking Shabbos. I'll Shomer you, I'll say. We'll hold hands, skip back to Brooklyn before sundown.
When I was reading your materials when you talked about a culture of self in its own form and how we reckon ourselves with that. And experiencing this, I also thought about what empathy is subject in terms of that, within that form. So I was going to talk about that in terms of your response.
Sure, I should say, I'm not very good at writing papers, so it probably was all wrong. Yeah, you know, I'm a playwright, and I write plays. What plays are, what they look like, and I fully believe in the expansive possibility of plays, and their own composite possibility. Having said, this piece is one play, a series of things that sort of emerged starting last summer for me, and I'm particularly interested in the spectator, and for me, when I'm working on the spectator, is always sort of the question mark, but also kind of the key, and so this was some of my thoughts as I was working on this piece, and I'm interested that, you know, to hear more from you or to hear more from anyone about their experience engaging in work, and to that question.
So, because of time, I'm going to just go through, and I feel like if we have any time at the end that we can have people react to some of the questions that artists may have. So, we also, so in a very different way, as in Phillip's piece, I found as giving conversations, and actually, we were having this experience, we were hearing about it from you, but also in a way that is really addressing, as you're saying here, the giving voice to the voiceless and helping someone empathize with someone. The voice name I'm not for. Could you talk a little bit more about that in your work?
Yeah, sure. Work addresses the prison industrial complex, also known as mass incarceration, and it currently is, in my opinion, a human rights issue, that's living in America. And so, as an artist, I felt a responsibility to. My art as a vehicle to put a face on the statistics, because, you know, we're inundated with numbers, but numbers have faces and families, and there's a humanity that I think gets lost and disconnected when it just becomes intellectual or scholarly thought and people.
Yeah, that was very, very clear. The information that we got it through. For relating to someone's experience. And in a very, when I was reading your bio, I was thinking about improvisation as a main tool for research and creation. That was something that jumped out to me in terms of identity, like as a choreographer and a dancer. But also, watching it occurred to me at the topic of immediacy, also being your identity in that moment. So,
yeah, sure. I think one of my starting points as a performer is inescapable as someone in my own work. And so we were to say 80. I'm almost 40, so I kind of, as a dancer, that's kind of aging, I guess. the starting point is like that your ineptitudes, the ways that you fail at this task of dancing, which is supposed to be this, always has this heroicism and this grandiosity to it, that making that material, so allowing your pains, your day job, who you are, the things that you can't escape, to actually be able to watch you. And then allow absolutely as something. I'm always creative with a level of improvisation. The process that's been in the past 2 years where I started to feel that. And in practice and in a couple of even like piece of improvisation. So finding ways to formalize this thing that just comes naturally and actually still it and make it. Yeah, into a product.
And then you guys, the identities, like such a strong of the piece, where it come from cultural identity versus national American identity.
Stage now,
and I just like to interact. And it can really frustrate, and also a lot of people that move here from other places and they don't get that that's part of New York. I think Native Americans are into that. Like, you could have that theater piece play out right on the subway car. So move over, Joe Kansas. Like, we're living here.
I grew up in the hood. Awesome. Where you were talking.
For me, the call to action is about an awakening and awareness, and that maybe we're not, you know, cognizant of this, you know, human rights issue, and to get involved and to step outside of the zone. And so that's why, you know, as a playwright, I try and look at the with language to make people uncomfortable. Because, you know, comfort is where we don't grow. The discomfort is where the potential grows. And so that's, for me, that's a call to action. If you just go and move and change and think about something that you've never thought about, maybe, you know, you have an awareness, so maybe you might be inspired to get involved in an organization or a community-based organization or something. Or just have a little bit more compassion in your life and your perspective. To me, that's movement and that's growth.
It seemed to be like the aspect of empathy that was so strong, and you mentioned all the pieces today, that without that, the conflict is just after when you empathize with someone's knowledge or...
A little bit for myself, I want to see a separation between my artist life and my teaching life, and I find there's a lot of very healthy overlap there. It's the reason I think I always end up mentioning in my monologue my day job. Very often my students are sprinkled throughout the audience. I haven't really figured out some kind of process that directly engages folks within the organization per se, but I don't know, for me there's something about this humbling motion, the notion of always keeping the art at the same level as everything else, you know. So that's just some way I personally deal with it. I find when I've been, if I get a good run of performing the work or going to a retreat to do this work, I come back very enlightened as a teacher. I feel really empowered to maybe get people to do a little bit more idiosyncratic or just push their comforts, like you're saying. It's very tricky to, you know, everything's work. The question you're asking is a life process in itself. Very interesting question.
I'm going to answer your question. I don't have the answer to your question. I don't know if, for me, there is sort of a criteria or a way to enact something other than the work that we're creating. I would say, though, that it's really great to be here, you know, at Prelude, where, you know, there's an incredible pluralistic group of folks telling their stories in the way that they want to tell them, and you all are here to be able to receive them. You know, if we're talking about theater in the American theater, as many of us know, those of us who are engaged in it, sort of having a bit of an identity crisis right now. It's a little bit spiraling down a K-hole to figure out what it wants to look like and what it wants to be and who it wants to, whose stories it wants to tell. So I guess just being aware of that and supporting the theaters that are telling the stories that you're interested in hearing and that are look a little bit like this, I suppose, I would say. I think that would be a pretty cool way to begin.
How many people do we have a little bit of time? No, we don't. Okay. It's like, we have time, we can talk some more. Okay, well then in that case, I would like to thank you all. It was wonderful to see your work today and
Thank you. Is there any boss down here?